partner Sopal Sam could not make it today since he lives 13 hours away from here in Cambodia, Battambang, Cambodia. But there's a video of him during the presentation, so I hope you guys enjoy. So who am I? Again, my name is Naruko Yoshino. I graduated 2 years ago with sociology and Spanish major, and I was part of the GSP. So thank you so much, GSP, for this opportunity. And GSP really changed my life, for sure. I wouldn't be here standing here today if it wasn't for GSP, so thank you. And so after the graduation, I just wondered what I could do with my life with my sociology and Spanish major. And initially, I was going to go for a corporate job in New York, and I've been going through a lot of interviews and things. But then my heart wasn't telling me that corporate banking is not somewhere I belong. So I went home in Chicago, I was with my parents, and I just wondered what I could do with my life. And one day when I was just trying to buy a ticket for Copa America, because I'm a big soccer fan, I just came to this experience of discrimination against Asian just because of my name and my accent. And I grew up in the Netherlands and the United States for most of my life. And in the Western world, I've gone through so many discriminations, but I've never thought I would experience it right now. You know, I've been living in the United States for over 10 years now, and I was just so shocked. And then, but then at the same time, as hurtful that was a day that really changed my life, because I spontaneously bought tickets to Southeast Asia. Why? Because, growing up as an Asian person in the Western world, I never felt comfortable in my own skin. I never felt beautiful. I never felt confident in myself. But when I had that experience of discrimination, I started questioning myself. There must be some hidden beauty in Asia that I'm missing out. There's some cultural connections I could find in Asia that I haven't experienced growing up. So I just bought a ticket to go to Southeast Asia on the same day, and I traveled through Vietnam, Malaysia, Thailand, all through Southeast Asia by myself, and then I stumbled upon Cambodia, which really stole my heart. I crossed the border on the bus from Thailand to Cambodia, and then wow, Cambodia. These kids just surrounded me right when I crossed the border. I was like, what is this country? Why are these kids smiling? Why are these kids chasing after me? And the country literally just stole my heart right away. I knew I belong in this country. I'm not even from Cambodia, but they just welcomed me in right away. And I never felt so comfortable and confident in myself. And so I was wondering if I could get to know more about this country, if I could start talking to people, but I didn't know anybody there. I was traveling by myself. But then I knew there was a person, Mr. Wo, who used to be my chemistry teacher in Battle Creek, Michigan, who used to work in Japan, and every summer he would go to Cambodia to volunteer. So I called him. I was like, Mr. Wo, do you know anybody from Cambodia who I could connect to? And he was like, actually, there is one person that you might be interested in connecting to. And that was Sopal Sam, who has been working as an English teacher at a public school in Battambang, Cambodia, rural city. He's 22, but I'm sure he seems as if he's lived way longer than I have, and I'm 22, and he knows way more about how to live. That's Sopal in Battambang, Cambodia, and that's his school right there. I want to show you guys a video of him and how he grew up in Cambodia.
Later, my father came back to the gap because the job was not paying him. I didn't recognize who he was since I had never met him until then. Although he decided to try farming in the Gale, it was ruined by the flooding and we lost every property that we owned. For that, we made a decision to move to Waterbourne when I was only 5 years old. Life in Waterbourne was not so easy because my parents had no job and there were no relatives living here. My father spent 2 months to get a job as a construction worker on the border of Cambodia and Thailand, so he could get paid $5 a day. He saved up as much as possible and sent those money to home every month. When I was 6 years old, I attended the primary school by my house here in Baltimore. Every day after school, I came home early to take care of my sister because my mom went out to find jobs at our neighbor's house to wash dishes, harvest rice, cook cassava, and clean houses. Every weekend, I took care of the neighbor's cows in the rice paddles to get some money for families. After primary and secondary school, I had to be away from home for high school. Since there was no transportation to commute to high school, I had to stay in a pagoda. Money to support my study became less because my mom couldn't work anymore since she needed to take care of my sister. Besides studying in high school, I attended an English class that was taught by a monk in the pagoda. And every weekend I went to villages to ask for things to do to get some extra money to support my home study. I spent 3 years living in the pagoda and studying English with the monk because of my work hard in high school and college classes. I was asked to teach a couple of students. I didn't ask for money, but the students always gave me food. My first year of my university was paid by those parents. I used to teach in the first year. I was trying so hard to apply as an English teacher. Then I got accepted to be an intern in organization. I got little money to continue my study, but 3 years ago I decided to open up an English school at my house in Baltimore. I did it because I wanted children whose parents are working in Thailand to have a chance to learn English. And English is very important to them because most of the textbooks in university are written in English. More importantly, by knowing English, it will give many students more opportunity to communicate and to utilize it for their advantages. Thank you very much for watching this video.
So this is Sophia Lee. My friend. This video was taken at his own house, which is also a school. This video was taken at 5 a.m. in the morning before he worked in his farm. His farm is right behind his house. That's why you can hear roosters crying. His life in Cambodia wasn't that easy growing up. He was so passionate about education growing up, but it's been a challenge. And a lot of times, in Bakabang, Cambodia, I'll show you a map of where Cambodia is, but Cambodia. but due to flooding, Sapal had lost every property in his family. So they had to move to Battambang, which is on the border of Cambodia and Thailand, so that his dad could work in Thailand as a constructionist. And then there's a reason behind, so you hear a lot about Vietnam and Thailand. So Thailand's a really popular place to travel right now. You know, like a lot of people are going there to see what it's like, but you don't really hear what Cambodia really is like. And still to this day, this country is struggling a lot with the economy because of the historical background. And I want to show you guys a little bit of history behind Cambodia and why there's lack in education still to this day. There's going to be a couple of difficult photos to see, so I apologize, but I'm going to be reading about a little history behind Cambodia. So Cambodia was ruled by Khmer Rouge until 38 years ago. The Khmer Rouge are a chapter in Cambodia's recent history that so many Cambodians would like to close, yet the effects of the brutal regime are still prevalent today. Upon seizing power in 1975, the Khmer Rouge, under the leadership of Pol Pot, undertook a barbarous restructuring of Cambodian society with the goal of transforming the country into a communist cooperative. The Khmer Rouge cut off communication with the rest of the world, abolished currency, closed schools, hospitals, and factories, and marched city dwellers into the countryside to undertake grueling slave labor. Intellectuals, professionals, and monks were tortured and executed, eliminating nearly an entire generation of the country's educated people. Almost 2 million people died in all, if not by torture and execution, by malnutrition and disease. The Vietnamese overthrew the Khmer Rouge in 1979, but the Khmer Rouge maintained a guerrilla war throughout the 1980s from areas around Thailand-Cambodia border. The 1990s brought the restatement of Cambodia's constitutional monarchy and UN administered elections, but were still riddling with fighting. It wasn't until 1999 that Cambodia finally had peace. So that's really recent. That's why still to this day there's a lack in education. All the schools were converted into killing places and execution places. So when you're in Cambodia, you barely see any schools because those places were used for labor camps in Cambodia. So that's why Sapal has started a school in his rural area in Cambodia, because there isn't that many schools. And even though there are schools, not many kids get to go to schools because they're working in their farms. And therefore his schools are in the afternoons or at night. There are 6 classes, level 1 through 6, and we have about 60 students right now, from 6 years old to 45 years old. And the school is free, and Sapal has been teaching for 3 years for free. So this summer I reached out to Sapal. I left Cambodia in September to start working as a social worker in New York. But we've been in touch for, you know, the whole time. Every week we've been communicating each other. And one day in May, I called him. I was like, Sapal, your English is so good, and you have so much potential in your life, but what would you like to do with your life? Do you want to go outside of Cambodia? Do you want to come to the United States? And he had said, I want to start my own school. And he already did have his school, but I was like, you already have a school, so what are you lacking in? And he told me the school cannot be administered under Ministry of Education because there's lack of funding. So he's such an inspiration to me. So I told him, what could I do in order to support you and your dreams? You have already inspired me as a person. So what could I do for you? And he said, okay, I want to work with you to administer this school under Minister of Education. So okay, I created a GoFundMe in the summer, and I was able to fundraise about $600. And now the school is administered under Minister of Education. And now the kids, when they graduate from his school, they're able to get a certification. And then we came up with a logo, Bright Life for a Language School. The meaning behind it is that there's so many kids who are lacking in access to textbooks that at his school, when kids touch their textbooks, their whole lives turn brighter because they're gaining some education in them. So that's why we came up with this logo of sunlight and trees and books. Bright Life, Foreign Language School. write them back. And the CZ members have been correcting the kids' essays so that the kids can learn English while they're writing. And at the same time, they're trying to share their cultures, because in Cambodia, they're still lacking in the access to the internet. So by writing each other, they are trying to learn what their cultures are really like. And other things that we're working on is a curriculum write-up. The school does not have lesson planning or curriculum just yet. So what my goal really is to incorporate, so English is very important to Cambodia, but Cambodian culture is more important. So how can we incorporate Cambodian culture into the language of English? And all the textbooks that a lot of schools in Cambodia are using are from the United States or United Kingdom. So, I mean, it's nice to learn about hamburgers and hot dogs in textbooks, but it's more important to learn to incorporate the culture of Cambodia into lesson plans. So, tourism is one of the second most important factor of the economy in Cambodia right now, after agriculture. So something that we've been trying to work on is incorporate tourism into lesson planning so that the kids can have more interest in English language, so that they can connect with their own language or their own culture. So global citizenship, I mean, this is like a global citizenship conference. So how could my experience connect to global citizenship? To be honest, when people ask me what the meaning of global citizenship really is, I always say, I don't know. I really don't know. I mean, the word is so big. But then when you break apart the word into global and citizenship, we're all citizens of this globe. And everybody can, I want to talk about energy. So there's so much energy towards hatred right now. And when we're all born in this world, in this beautiful globe, we're born to learn how to hate and love. But why do we use our hatred more often than to love something? If we love more than to hate, maybe the world will start changing a little more. We're all citizens. It doesn't have to be, we don't have to travel to 30 countries in order to be a global citizen, because we already are global citizens of this world. So just utilizing it and controlling, because the energy is so fluid and flexible, so why don't we use this energy to love more people and to start caring about more people and connect to people and no judgment, than to hate and, you know, kill and be brutal to each other, because there's no reason to, because we're gonna end up living for 80 years, for example, in a healthy lifestyle. We're gonna be living for over 80 years right now. So why don't we use this energy and this body to love other people? So that's my meaning of global citizenship. It's not a straight answer, it's not a definition, but it's how I try to define what global citizenship is. So this will conclude my presentation. So thank you so much. If you guys have a cell phone, please take a picture of this presentation so you can start following us on social media. It's very new, so there are not many posts yet, but we're gonna be posting it every week. More support, the better. If you guys have any ideas in fundraising, let me know. We're always collecting new ideas to this organization. So thank you so much. Any questions? If you're interested in becoming a part of Pen Pal, let me know. Kids love to write and connect. They're 6 years old to 45 years old, so the age is very wide. And there are 60 students in the school. Any other questions? Sean?
I know you mentioned it a little bit, but like, what does it look like when you talk about like incorporating stuff that's relevant to their culture, mm-hmm. at the same time giving them a curriculum? Because you could like, and I like that you mentioned that too, because you could run the risk of indoctrinating them, and like that's what the U.S. do as a whole anyway, is
factor to coming up with a curriculum that connects to the culture is to connect to their lifestyle, what their dreams are, what they're passionate about. Because these kids have passions and dreams. They all want to go to college, but in order to go to college, they have to know English because all the textbooks are written in English. But then, they have dreams and goals, but the English that they're learning right now won't really be able to be used in a society when they step out of the classroom, because there are words such as yellow, red, hamburgers. But if they try, when they start learning about the structures of how the temples are made, that's something that they're already familiar with. But then they're not familiar in English, so why don't we just start incorporating how to explain the temple in English, so they could start using that when they step out of the classrooms of society. Any other questions?
Along those terms, what's the now that it's students are able to get education and write about it.
Mm-hmm.
What's the process for textbook adoption?
Yes. He's the main teacher, but his friends do come and volunteer, who are his teacher friends. Because he does have six classes. And oftentimes he invites his friends to teach. majority of ages, it's more on English levels than ages.
This isn't a question. I just want to say I really like what you're doing. I think a theme we often see in like international outreach is instead of empowering the people that are already there, getting them really activated and willing to do things, we transplant people from Western culture to really do things for them.
If you guys have any questions, please reach out to me through email, social media. I'm always on it. If you guys have any ideas to expand, opportunities for these kids and the other ideas to make this school better, let me know. I'm really interested. This is a really new project we've been working on since May, so more ideas, the better. So